Hey, good morning. Welcome. Welcome to the 11 o'clock worship service of New Treoso Bible Church. And I think we got everybody. All right, good. Today is the day the Lord has made, am I right? And what should we do with that? Rejoice and be glad in it. Well, today is also another day. Thought I'd clue you in on this. Today is National Sunday Supper Day. Bet you didn't know that, did you? And you're probably wondering, well, what do we do on National Sunday Supper Day? I'll tell you. Supper. Not suffer. Okay, well, National, and I wrote this down because I knew that everyone here would want to know. Am I right? Shake your head, yes. Okay, National Sunday Supper Day encourages families to gather around the table and enjoy a meal and a conversation together. Remember those days? Remember the TV show Leave It to Beaver? And they all sat down every evening and ate supper together? That's what National Sunday Supper Day is, but they're encouraging you to do it on a Sunday. So, and I can't think of something better to have for supper. I didn't say that. I'm just letting you know I've got something in mind. Okay. Today is also part of our, got it right side up, Fifth Sunday Missions Day, or month, I should say. There's 4 months in the year that have 5 Sundays. And when we enter into one of those months, our missionaries there on the board rotate through those 4 months, and this month is Randy and Rhonda Elliott's month to be the recipient of our Fifth Sunday Missions offering. It's a special offering that we take to show them that we support and love them. Nancy is passing out the email from Randy and Rhonda Elliott. He is the chaplain at the main jail in Camp Verde, Arizona, for Yavapai County. And his church is 560 men and women. So she's passing that out. I get those salt and lights once a week from Randy. And what's unique about Randy, and Gay is passing out pictures that go with that. What's unique is that this is a recap. This salt and light is a 2021 recap for his ministry there in Camp Verde. And it is, if you read that, it will give you goosebumps. There were over 900 decisions for Christ in that jail in 2021. I think he's got the exact number there. The number of Bibles that they were able to distribute, and the number of Bible correspondence courses that those inmates are enrolled in. It's just, I mean, God has Randy and Rhonda exactly where he wants them. Let me, if you get your pen out, okay, I want to give you a correction on Randy and Rhonda's mailing address there in Camp Verde. Okay, so I'll give you a minute to get your pen out. Okay, does everyone have a pen that needs a pen? Yes? Okay. His mailing address is 1230 instead of the one in Mayer, Arizona. It's 1230 West Buffalo Trail. Sounds western, doesn't it? You bet. 1230 West Buffalo Trail. In Camp Verde, it's two words, and the zip is 86322, I'll say it again, 86322, and he's got on here, evidently they want him to use the -7400. So, Randy and Rhonda Elliott, 1230 West Buffalo Trail, Camp Verde, Arizona, 86322-7400. drop them a line, send them a card, anything that comes their way that says Nutrioso Bible Church, they get excited about. They love this church, and we love them. Okay. Thank you, Gay and Nancy, for passing those out. I thought that email this time would be just perfect to read. Let's grab the bulletins. Doesn't Linda do a great job? I like the way the neon, she picks the neon ones that just sort of, if you go outside at night, you can hold the bulletin in front of you like that and see where you're going. The church bulletin board, NBC Ladies Luncheon, is coming up on the 15th of this month from 11 to 1. RSVP to Kim Goldshot, and there's her number. And let's see. Men's breakfast is coming up a few days after that, the 22nd, in the fellowship hall. And man, can we put away the grub, right, Mark? And doors open at 7, and we start grazing at about 7:30, and then Tom has a special movie or something to show. And actually, you're the chef this coming time. All right. So plan to attend that, men, and you'll be glad you did. A lot of good fellowship. Great fellowship, as a matter of fact. And then the Bible study is, look at this, just boom, the 15th, the 22nd, the 18th, January is full of stuff. Bible study returns at 2 p.m. on Tuesday, January the 18th. Okay, I think I got all of the pending announcements. Are there any other announcements that need to be made that I'm not aware of? Mark is ready with the mic, if there is. No? Okay. We'll move on to prayer requests and praises. We've got, if you just look around you, we're missing a lot of our family this morning. And lots of our folks have been and are under the weather, feeling sick. We've got a special update that has been going around through the congregation on the Wood family. And please keep Crystal Wood and the entire Wood family in your prayers. The Diane, Jim's wife, for those of you that don't know the Wood family, has been sending out some great updates. Do you folks have anything more recent than Mark, would you take the mic over to Robert, please? Thank you, Robert.
Is that on? Are you guys, just in case some don't know, but Chris, just the day before Christmas, my sister-in-law was exposed to COVID, and she held off on going to the doctors just because we thought it was normal stuff. She thought it was normal stuff. On Sunday after Christmas, they did take a COVID test, and it was positive, and Monday morning, my brother couldn't wake her up. He tested her blood sugar, blood oxygen, and it was at 40. So called the ambulance, and they verified it at 38, and they took her into the Springerville. And I guarantee you, if there was anybody in my family that didn't think that prayers were heard or answered, Tuesday morning, she coded when they were trying to intubate her. And they immediately started CPR. I left work immediately, sending out prayer requests, and on the way Springerville, the doctor was in the process of declaring the time of death, and her heart started beating. So obviously you can feel the prayers there. To jump forward to now, there's been some struggles throughout, but as of last night, I'll just go ahead and read my last night's update and explain it after I read it. But as it says, some positive news this evening. Blood gases are stabilizing, and they were able to begin reducing the settings on the ventilator. She's still at 50% oxygen, but respirations per minute have been slowed to 16. They were at 22. And the ventilator pressure has been reduced from 16 to 14. Little explanation on that. I don't really know what the 16 to 14 numbers mean, but I do know that on normal patients, they keep them at, they don't go any higher than 12. COVID patients, they go to 16. So to be able to come down a little bit is a big improvement. This is necessary to begin the process of removing the ventilator. Still a long way to go, but this is good news. They did have an incident with the sedative. She came too far out and began to agitate and pull against the restraints. It's a good sign, but they did not want her to come out that far. Good news is she did come out of the sedation somewhat, and now she is voluntarily moving her head and extremities. They will try neuro exams again after she rests a while from the activity this afternoon. And one of the big fears or worries there for the doctors was being without oxygen and a heartbeat for 30 minutes, there would be no brain activity. But when they brought her out and she started pulling at the restraints, they were not involuntary movements. They were not seizures. They were voluntarily. She was trying to remove her restraints. So that is a big praise and thankful for knowing that there is some brain activity. So obviously there is a long way to go. So the prayer requests are still being felt, and we just thank everybody that's been praying, and there are as positive signs as of today.
Thank you, Robert. And you've seen Jim and Diane. Most of you know Jim and Diane. They usually sit right there on the same row. Robert is their son, and is James that is Crystal's husband. So the entire Wood family, as you can tell, appreciate your prayers. Any other? Okay. Denise?
Previously, I asked for prayer for my sister-in-law's grandchildren. They had been doing better after COVID. All four grandchildren had it. The baby, James, is back in the hospital. They can't get his oxygen levels above 80. So Stephen was in for a little while, the second to the youngest, and James is still in the hospital. And so there's a struggle there. They say there's permanent damage to his lungs. So both of the younger ones are going to probably have some difficulties. And then RSV set in. So pray for James and Stephen and the Hammond family.
Thanks, Denise.
And my husband.
And Fred. Linda's got a request.
I just wanted to tell everyone thank you for praying for my husband. Last Monday, he had his epidural, and he got some relief. It's not, you know, it's not as good as what they are hoping for, but he gets another injection, two injections, the 17th, so I hope that maybe another couple of injections, it'll maybe make it to where he's feeling better. So, but anyway, thank you.
You are welcome. NBC is a praying church.
Amen.
Absolutely. Any other prayer requests? Heidi.
I just ask for prayers for my brother, who had two strokes, like one right on top of another, and he is trying to make his way back. So prayers for his recovery, his healing.
Thank you.
His name is Mike J.
Gay and I have been asking you to pray for a dear family, good friends to us, Tom and Katie Dameron. They live in Tucson half the year, come up here half the year. Tom, a very special friend who developed Hodgkin's disease, long story short, went through the bone marrow transplant, was doing wonderful this summer. He became ill recently, and complications getting in and out of needed hospitals. We'll just leave it there. This is a kind of a bittersweet morning for Gay and I, because for Katie, she loves Tom with all of her heart and the family. Tom won't be at the dinner table. He has gone home to be with the Lord. Tom had a faith that was dynamic. He and I talked about the possibility that this would happen, and there was never a twitch in his eye. He said, I'm ready, Tom. I want to be here with the family, but if God calls me home, I know it's going to be great. So this morning, as we are here, he is spending his first day in heaven. So I rejoice in what he's experiencing, but I ask that you would pray for Katie and the family, please.
I just wanted to give a praise report on, I get answered prayers. I just love them. I have prayed for Dick to find a church that he would like to attend. And we've looked and looked and looked, and we've visited here before, and he's been okay with it. But we came again just before Christmas, and when we got in the truck to go home, he said, I found a church I like to go to. And he's very sorry he's not here today, but it's the only day his buddy can help him put the transfer case back in his truck. So he said to tell everybody hi, and he will see you next week.
Thank you, Kate. Jackie, transfer cases are important. Any other prayer requests? Okay. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, as we commit these prayer requests to you today, we realize that in your sovereignty, you already knew what they were going to be. And we know that you are at work in each of these individual cases. And Lord, what a blessing it is to be able to turn these over to you. We just ask that you would intervene in these situations. We praise you for the progress that has been made. Our family is sick and needs to recover, and we know that you are working to see that come about. Lord, we just thank you for who you are. And we ask for the comfort. We ask you to just come alongside the Wood family, Lord, and just embrace them and let them feel your presence. And for the rest of our family members that are sick, Lord, we just ask that they be able to feel you right there in the room. We commit these things to you, Father, knowing that we can. Knowing that you'll work. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. How many of you would say amen to that? This has been a kind of a unique last couple of years. Amen. First of all, I'd like to apologize that we did not have a Christmas Eve service, or even that we were not able to come together like this last week. I will tell you now, as a pastor and just as a believer, nothing, nothing breaks my heart more than to not be together with you. The situation was that Thursday about noon, I had wrapped up everything. Everything was in place for a great Christmas Eve service. We had a lot of folks from the community saying we are going to come join you. And about 12 o'clock, I started getting rapid emails and phone calls saying, Tom, I don't know what I have, but I have never felt this sick before. And by the time I took a count, it was about 65% that I was able to contact the 70% of our members who were affected. To ask people to come together from the community and all with the chance that there would be people in this congregation who might be carriers, invite people to come in here and sing and praise and pass that on to them, I could not in good conscience do that, and I don't believe God in good conscience expected me to. And that has continued today. We have had people who have been ill for up to 4 weeks, and they're still not with us. They're doing much better. But I ask you to forgive us. This is not Tom's getting a chance for a day off. I'm going to tell you, those weeks I was working as hard, if not harder, than I normally would. But again, as a shepherd, it is my responsibility to not only work to protect the souls of those who are with me, but to not put them foolishly at risk. You know, somebody says, well, faith. But I think about the Apostle Paul when he left Damascus. He didn't just walk out the gate and say, God's going to protect me. He went over the wall. Sometimes God says, use some prudence. And that's what I did. And I'm so happy we're back. Thank you that you're able to join with me today. But as a part of what we're going through right now, a significant part of our music team is still ill. One is out of town. That person will be back. So we don't have anybody to lead worship. But that doesn't matter, because when Satan throws curve, God hits home runs. And so this morning, we're going to do something different than raise our voice in prayer. We're going to use God's word as a way to give praise and glory to him. And I have four people who are going to read some passages that will help lead to today's message, which, by the way, has a Christmas and an Easter theme, because Christmas is not, if it doesn't happen on this day, it doesn't count. Christmas, the spirit of Christmas, is a 365-day-a-year thing, and that's what we're going to do. So with that, I'm going to ask that we have some people who have volunteered to read come up. I am going to ask that you would do one thing. Is that on? Yes, no? Is that on, Jenny? Okay, the readers, because you're not used to these mics, you have to keep it just like this. I'm sorry, but it will not pick up, and people are going to flash tag those guys back there saying, we can't hear. So please keep it like that. And so with that, we'll have our first reading, which is... The next slide. Isaiah 9, 2, 6, and 7.
Good morning. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. And those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. For unto us a child is born, to us a son.
Amen.
And the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness. From that time on and forever, the zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
Amen. Amen. Praise God.
Who's next?
Just put the next slide up.
Sorry. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me? So far from my cries of anguish? My God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer. By night, I find no rest. Yet you are enthroned as the Holy One. You are the one Israel praises. In you, our ancestors put their trust. They trusted, and you delivered them. To you, they cried out and were saved. In you, they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not a man, scorned by everyone, despised by people. All who see me mock me. They hurl insults, shaking their heads. He trusts in the Lord, they say. Let the Lord rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. Yet you brought me out of the womb. You made me trust you, even at my mother's breast. From birth, I was cast on you. From my mother's womb, you have been my God. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help. Many bulls surround me. Strong bulls of Bashan encircle me. Roaring lions that tear their prey open their mouths wide against me. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart has turned to wax. It is melted within me. My mouth is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. You lay me in the dust of death. Dogs surround me. A pack of villains encircles me. They pierce my hands and my feet. All my bones are on display. People stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothing among them and cast lots for my garment. But you, Lord, do not be far from me. You are my strength. Come quickly to help me. Deliver me from the sword, my precious life, from the power of the dogs. Rescue me from the mouth of the lions. Save me from the horns of the wild oxen. I will declare your name to my people, and in assembly I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, honor him. Revere him, all you descendants of Israel. For he has not despised or scorned the suffering of the afflicted one. He has not hidden his face from him, but has listened to his cry for help. From you comes the theme of my praise in the great assembly. Before those who fear you, I will fulfill my vows. The poor will eat and be satisfied. Those who seek the Lord will praise him. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations will bow down before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. All the rich of the earth will feast and worship. All who go down to the dust will kneel before him. Those who cannot keep themselves alive, prosperity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord. They will proclaim his righteousness, declaring to the people yet unborn, he has done it.
Amen.
I'm reading from Psalm 18. It's a long one, so you may want to read along. I love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God is my rock in whom I take refuge. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call to the Lord who is worthy of praise, and I am saved from my enemies. The cords of death entangled me. The torrents of destruction overwhelmed me. The cords of the grave coiled around me. The snares of death confronted me. In my distress, I called to the Lord. I cried to my God for help. From his temple, he heard my voice. My cry came before him into his ears. The earth trembled and quaked, and the foundations of the mountains shook. They trembled because he was angry. Smoke rose from his nostrils. Consuming fire came from his mouth. Burning coals blazed out of it. He parted the heavens and came down. Dark clouds were under his feet. He mounted the cherubim and flew. He soared on the wings of the wind. He made darkness his covering, his canopy around him, the dark rain clouds of the sky. Out of the brightness of his presence, clouds advanced with hailstones and bolts of lightning. The Lord thundered from heaven. The voice of the Most High resounded. He shot his arrows and scattered the enemies, great bolts of lightning, and routed them. The valleys of the sea were exposed, and the foundations of the earth laid bare at your rebuke, O Lord, at the blast of breath from your nostrils. He reached down from on high and took hold of me. He drew me out of deep waters. He rescued me from my powerful enemy, from my foes who were too strong for me. They confronted me in the day of my disaster, but the Lord was my support. He brought me out into a spacious place. He rescued me because he delighted in me. The Lord has dealt with me according to my righteousness. According to the cleanness of my hands, he has rewarded me. For I have kept the ways of the Lord. I have not done evil by turning away from my God. All his laws are before me. I have not turned away from his decrees. I have been blameless before him and have kept myself from sin. The Lord has rewarded me according to my righteousness, according to the cleanness of my hands in his sight. To the faithful, you show yourself faithful. To the blameless, you show yourself blameless. To the pure, you show yourself pure. But to the crooked, you show yourself shrewd. You save the humble, but bring low those whose eyes are haughty. You, O Lord, keep my lamp burning. My God turns my darkness into light. With your help, I can advance against a troop. With my God, I can scale a wall. As for God, his way is perfect. The word of the Lord is flawless. He is a shield for all who take refuge in him. For who is God beside the Lord? And who is the rock except our God? It is God who arms me with strength and makes my way perfect. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer. He enables me to stand on the heights. He trains my hands for battle. My arms can bend a bow of bronze. You give me your shield of victory, and your right hand sustains me. You stoop down to make me great. You broaden the path beneath me so that my ankles do not turn. I pursued my enemies and overtook them. I did not turn back till they were destroyed. I crushed them so that they could not rise. They fell beneath my feet. You armed me with strength for battle. You made my adversaries bow at my feet. You made my enemies turn their backs in flight, and I destroyed my foes. They cried for help, but there was no one there to save them. To the Lord, but he did not answer. I beat them as fine as dust borne on the wind. I poured them out like mud in the streets. You have delivered me from the attacks of the people. You have made me the head of nations. People I did not know are subject to me. As soon as they hear me, they obey me. Foreigners cringe before me. They all lose heart. They come trembling from their strongholds. The Lord lives. Praise be to my rock. Exalted be my God, my Savior. Exalted be God, my Savior. He is the God who avenges me, who subdues nations under me, who saves me from my enemies. You exalted me above my foes. From violent men you rescued me. Therefore, I will praise you among the nations, O Lord. I will sing praises to your name. He gives his king great victories. He shows unfailing kindness to his anointed, to David and his descendants forever.
Amen.
Came to pass in those days that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. The census first took place while Quirinius was governing Syria. So all went to be registered, everyone to his own city. Joseph also went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth into Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed wife, who was with child. So it was that while they were there, the days were complete for her to be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men." So it was, when the angels had gone away from them into heaven, that the shepherds said to one another, "Let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us." And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. Now when they had seen him, they made widely known the sayings which was told them concerning this child. And all those who heard it marveled in those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. Then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, as it was told to them.
Amen. Let me ask you, are there any words that give more wisdom than the Word of God? Are there any words that bring more sweetness to the ear and the heart than what has been given to man by the Holy Spirit? These are words not only of truth, but they are words of life. And I'd like you to stand for just a moment and share with me, we don't do this often, but let's honor God by bowing in prayer and reciting together the Lord's Prayer. Would you stand with me, please? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please be seated. This morning, I'd like to share a story with you. But in order for you to get into the spirit of the story, I'd like you to do some personal visualization. I want you to imagine right now that you're in the Galilean mountains. There's a big bonfire, and around that bonfire are a large number of men, women, and children. And if you'll look at the folks who are there, look at what they're doing. They're not just staring into the fire, but they are looking in the direction of a single person. This single person is obviously an older woman. Her clothing is of the period of Jesus, something that the peasants might have worn. It's nothing fancy. It's almost nondescript. Then I want you to look, if you will, a little closer at the face of the woman that I'm talking about. You'll see, if you look close, some wrinkles. And those wrinkles have come partly because of the harsh desert landscape, the mountains living out in amongst it, and also just because of the difficulty of life that she's experienced. And then I want you to take another look at her and look at her countenance. Her countenance has a little bit of a weariness to it, but there's a reason for that. This woman, over the course of her years, has lost a husband. Because the loss of a husband, had to help raise a number of children. She has barely recently, just a few years before maybe, watched her eldest son rejected by his countrymen, by his peers. And it's not just rejection that we don't like you, but he's been tortured. He's been crucified. And she had to watch that all take place, something that a mother should never have to do. And yet, you look within those eyes, and you don't see a hardness of heart, but instead you see a serenity, a peace, a calm, a sense of all is right. And you ask yourself, who is this woman that all of these people are looking at? And the question's answered by a little girl who's sitting around that campfire, and she, with an innocent voice, says, Mary, what was it like the night that you brought Jesus into the world? What was the night like, the night that Jesus was born? And who is this woman? It is. It's Mary, the mother of Jesus. Now, I want you to listen to her words, because I think they might have gone something like this. I think if you'd looked at Mary, you would have looked at her face, and as she reflected, looking in the fire, you might have seen a little smile come, and she says, "Child, that night was like no night that I have ever experienced or ever will experience again. Oh, my precious Joseph, he was going crazy. We'd come into Bethlehem to take care of our responsibility at the census. Here I am, very pregnant. And every time he knocks on a door, he gets the same response. There's no room here. There's no room here." And Joseph, just like any good, loving husband who cares for his wife, he's getting a little bit desperate. He's getting extremely frustrated because it's my responsibility to take care of my wife, and I'm not getting the job done. And I have to admit that as I watched Joseph go, every time he came back, I saw him getting closer and closer to just losing it because he wants to find a place for me. And yet there is nothing. And I remember taking Joseph's hand and holding it and putting my hand to the side of his face and saying, "Joseph, be patient. Have faith. His father will find a place for him. He will provide." And you know, just about the time I said that, within just another few knocks on the door, I see Joseph standing at the door a little bit longer than at any other doors, and he's talking to the man. And he comes back with his head down and he says, "Mary, I'm sorry, it's the best I can do." He says that he has no room in the house, but the way his house is built, the stable is just underneath, and he's already put the animals away for the evening, and there's fresh straw down there that we can use, and there's room, and we're welcome to it. It's not what I want, Mary, but it'll do, Joseph. It will do. God has provided. And God provided at just about the right moment, because it seemed like I had no more than gotten into that stable and we'd laid out our goods that I felt those feelings that my mother told me I would feel before the baby came. And you know, I'd always dreamed that when I had my first baby, I'd be surrounded by my mom and relatives and midwives. But here I am, over 100 miles from home, not in the company of my family, not having midwives wait on me, but my husband, straw for my bed, animals watching down on me, not midwives. But God was good, and the child was born. And I can remember, after it was all over, watching as Joseph came and cleaned that little baby. And I remember that the man who had given us the place, he had sheep, and he had provided some special cloth that they wrapped the baby lambs in. It was clean, he said, swaddling cloth. And I watched as Joseph wrapped my baby. And I remember him slowly handing Jesus down to me. And I laid him on my breast, and I can remember looking at him, looking at that beautiful, innocent face, looking at those sweet little hands. And I remember saying to myself, "Are you really the Messiah? Am I holding the Messiah in my hand? Are you really God's son? You look so fragile. You look so vulnerable." And while I was thinking of this, Joseph knew I was tired. And he reached down and he said, "Mary, you need some rest. Let me take the baby." And he reached down and he picked up and he took Jesus. And I remember turning my head as he walked over to a feed stall, a manger, and he laid him carefully in that manger. And I remember saying to myself, how strange. God in human form on earth, God's son. And where does he spend his first night on earth? In a feed stall. How strange. And I said to myself, how strange that a woman travels 100 miles away from her family, very pregnant, to be giving birth in a foreign town, in a stable. But God, I believe this is your plan. I believe this is your will. And as I submitted to myself in the beginning, I submit myself to you now. And I began to prepare to go to sleep because I was tired. And just as I was starting to nod off and Jesus, I saw Joseph standing, staring down into that manger we heard of. And I saw Joseph stand up startled. Who in the world could that be? We know nobody in this town. We're in a stable. Who could be looking for us? Who could it be? Joseph, again, trying to be so very protective, went and carefully opened the door. And I heard him say, who are you? What do you want? My wife's just had a baby. She's tired. Go away. Come back later. I remember looking over, Joseph, who is it? Some shepherds. Now, one of the little boys who are around the campfire just pulls back in horror. Shepherds. Mary, Joseph didn't let him in. My rabbi told me about shepherds. They're dirty. They're crude. They are people who are on the same category as sinners and tax collectors. You didn't let people like that in, did you, in the middle of the night? Mary smiled and said, you know, my young friend, my husband Joseph had heard those same stories. And he was shocked when he saw those men who smelled of sheep and all. And he looked at me. And then they said, wait, before you shut the door, we have a story to tell you. A story to tell you. This actually happened to us just a short while ago. We were out tending our sheep in the fields, the same lambs that would be used in sacrifice. And it was out there in the middle of the night. We heard the same sounds that we'd already had always heard. And all of a sudden, standing before us was this mighty creature, and we recognized that it was an angel, and he was literally covered in a heavenly glow. And we dropped to our knees when he spoke, because we thought, surely, he tells us, that's what all of the rabbis tell us. He must be here to punish us for something that we have done. But when we were on our knees, he said, don't be afraid. I'm not here to harm you. I'm here to give you good news. Words of great joy for all people. Tonight in the city of David, a child is born who is not only the Messiah of the world that you've been waiting so long for, but he will be the Savior of the world. But then he did something very strange, and that's the reason we're here. He told us, go seek the child. You'll find him in a stable. You'll find him in a manger. And he'll be wrapped, not in the normal clothes that a child would be given by his mother, but in swaddling cloths, what we use to wrap new lambs with. And we've been out looking and we've been guided here. Is that the child? Can we come in? And Joseph looks back at Mary and let him in, Joseph. I remember saying, let him in. And they stepped in and they were just what I imagined shepherds would be. They smelled of sweat. They were dirty from the fields. They smelled like the sheep that they stood by all day. They were not real pleasant. They were rugged men. But when they walked in and they said, "Is that the child? May we see?" And I said, "Yes." They walked over like schoolboys who were almost afraid to approach somebody of great stature. They were so humble. And they came and they looked down in so carefully. And I remember one of them looking at me and saying, "Would you allow us to pick him up?" And Joseph's really looking at me then. And I said, "It's okay." And Joseph reached in and picked up Jesus and handed them. And they handled him just like they had every dear little lamb that they had helped bring into this world. They were so tender. They were so very tender. And you could see tears beginning to stream down their dirty face. And as the tears ran, it left little streaks almost like creek beds in the dirt on their face. And they were so happy and they rejoiced so much. And they so gently handed Jesus back to Joseph and said, "We're going to leave now." And as they went out the door, they were like school kids laughing on a break. And you could hear them going down the streets in the night, rejoicing over what was going on. And Joseph looked at me and I looked at him and we were just filled with wonder. He brought us two guests. He brought us Jesus that night and he brought us shepherds. One of the men around the campfire looked at Mary and he said, "Mary, when the next morning came, what did you think about everything that had occurred? What thoughts came to your mind?" And he says, "You know, I still remember some of those thoughts. And the first thought I thought about was, why me, God? Why did you choose me to be the mother of your son? I'm a nobody. I'm a peasant girl. I'm young. I have no great education. I was brought up in a town that everybody laughs at, where the, you know, to be from Nazareth is to be from nowhere. Why me? Why didn't you find some rich queen or some person of nobility or some great religious family? Wouldn't they have been better to have brought your son up than me?" And then I can remember laying there and saying, "Why, God? Why did you, the father of my child, allow this child to be born in a stable? You could have opened any door in this town of Bethlehem and gotten us the best of accommodations. You could have arranged for a great celebration, a historic arrival. And yet it seems like you're almost hiding away from the community this great news in a stable. Why would the Son of the Most High be born in a place like this?" And the announcement, the shepherds, these men are worse than obscure. Who's going to listen to the message that they have? Their testimony can't even be used in a court of law. And yet you send your angels to them specifically to announce the most wonderful historical event that's ever happened. Why, God? Why not Herod? Why not the high priest? Why not some great rabbi? Why shepherds? And then I seem to hear the answer to my thoughts. And I heard God say to me within my heart, "Mary, you're anything but a nobody to me. Do you really think it's education that impresses me? Do you really think that it's how big your land holdings are, your pocketbook, that really matter to me and give you value and worth to me? Do you really think that it's who considers you to be worth anything? In other words, your popularity, that's what I look at when I pick people? Absolutely not. I'm here with a message that I want you to hear loud and clear, and I want this world to hear loud and clear. what I look at is not what other people think of you or what you think of yourself, but what I see in your heart. Do you love me? Do you really love my word? And in loving that word, do you even care about doing the things that I ask you to do? Or does it humble you? Mary, I look at all these other people and I see something very unique and special in a 14, 15-year-old woman that I don't see in the rich and the famous. That's the reason you were selected, Mary. But then you asked me about a stable for the place of my birth. Why a stable? Because I'm making a statement. It was enough. Yes, this child is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. Yes, by human standards, he should have been born in a special palace or whatever. But I'm here to tell you that I will always provide for my people. But I will give them enough, not answer to their greeds. And I'm trying to tell you that a stable was enough. And that in your life, you may not have everything you want, but you will always be able to trust me in giving you what you need enough. But then the last thing is the shepherds. Why did I bring shepherds to announce the arrival of my son? Because I want to make a crystal clear statement to humanity that when I came, I was not here for the rich, the famous, the well-heeled, the super religious. I came for all people, the rejected as well as the renowned. I came for all men, and my message is for all men. You asked me what my first night with Jesus was like. That's what it was like. And it blessed me more than you could ever tell. And as I think about it, it still blesses me today. You know, in all of human history, you can find books filled with significant events, right? But may I tell you, there are two events. And if you have that slide, Jenny, there are two events that make everything else pale in comparison. I don't care what the event was, none of them come close to the manger and the cross. The manger reminds us that we had a great problem and that God came himself, Emmanuel, God with us. He came for one reason and one reason only. Four-letter word, and it's not the one that your mom's going to wash your mouth out with soap for. It's love. God loves you and me. He loves the rich and the poor. He loves the saint and the sinner because we're all sinners. And he came because we had a problem, a need that could not be handled in any other way than him coming as the true Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. When he came into this world, he came in as a lamb, wrapped in clothing of a lamb. And when he died as a sacrificial lamb while lambs were being sacrificed in the temple. He was on the cross being sacrificed for us to give us freedom from what our future would be. And this morning, I would like for you to remember. I like Christmas and I like Easter, but I'm getting really turned off by Christmas and Easter. May I tell you that? I love Christmas trees. I do. And Rudolph and Santa, but you know what the problem with all of that is? There are people who think that's all that there is. That is not what the season's about. That's not the reason for the season. The reason for the season is a baby that encapsulated God who came to save us. That's what Christmas is all about, and that is a message of being forgotten, even amongst some of God's children. And so this morning, I'd like you to join with me and remember personally that in this world, it was full of darkness. And one of the reasons I love candlelight so much is that this room is pitch black. And I can't do that this morning, so you'll have to imagine. But God came from heaven and took form, maybe. There it goes. And took human form, and the light of his presence was in that child. All of the creative power of this world right there. But he came not to just be the light, to share that light. The presence of his Holy Spirit. And here is the great truth of Christianity. We don't just share a light of truth and joy, but we are born again when we receive the message of Christ. And now not only is there more light, but it gives us the opportunity to go to those love that we love, like the shepherd. And we share that message from one to another as the shepherds went running through the streets telling the good news. And as we receive that good news, we can be born again, not just to be saved ourselves, but to share the light of salvation, which is Jesus Christ. That is what Christmas is all about, the light of the world coming. Throw the tree out, throw the gifts out, keep Jesus. Amen? But then, that's not the whole story. It's not just that God came, but God came with a mission. He came to take the penalty of our sins upon himself. Because if we were like my friend Tom, and had died and stood before Jesus without those sins being taken care of, this would not be a day of joy for me, but it would be a day of great sorrow, because my friend would be separated from God and joy and light eternally. But on the cross, Easter, where we confuse it with bunnies and eggs and hats and dinners, this is the feast our God hands to us that I want us to remember this morning. Could I have Gary and Skip come, please? And take one of the cups of the element and hold it until we can all take it together, please. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this truth. We thank you for this morning. We thank you for all that you have done to us. And for us, in Jesus' name, amen. As this is passed, take a moment and bow your head and remember the true reason, not only for the Christmas season, but the true reason for Easter, which again, help us remember the most significant events that have ever taken place in the course of all human history. This is it. Take a moment and reflect. The scriptures say that Jesus came to bring light and life. Look at what you have on this table in front of you. The light represented and the life that comes through only one place, Jesus. Many people will tell you there are many ways to heaven. I tell you this morning, without any reservation, without any shame, Jesus is the only way. The only way. And these things help us remember how he came and why he died. Take the bread at the bottom, please, and hold it and look at it for a second. Normally, I would say, remember the Christ on the cross, and that's good. But remember the child in the manger. That's where this body started. And in that body was embodied God himself. Come here not for a vacation, but on a mission to love you and me. Do you accept that? Do you appreciate it? Do you live for it? Take the body of our Lord. Father, I thank you so much. Thank you so much for your sacrifice, for your love, for you being the Lamb of God. You came as a lamb, you died as a lamb, and you were returned victorious at the end as a lamb. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. We also have the cup. When Jesus came into this world and his mother birthed him, there was blood. That was new life into the world. It was blood. What saves us from our sins? Blood. What gives us life? Blood. What can wash away my sins and your sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Take just a moment, reflect on that, and then we will take it together. Father, for this blood, I am truly thankful. It is not the blood, but it represents and it causes me to remember. Thank you so very much for your love, for all that you have taught me, for all that you are to me. Thank you for Jesus and the washing of my sins. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Take the cup. I wish I had a song that we could go out on, but we are going to. We are going to. Would you stand with me? What is the message? What is the reason God came to earth again? Love. There's an old song that we sang in Sunday school, a lot of us years ago, that I think is as applicable now as it was then, maybe more so. Jesus loves me. Let's say that. Let's sing that together and then let's go out. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. How do I know that those words are true? Look right there. If you can't feel the love, we need to talk. Go in God's grace, go in his peace, and go in the knowledge that when you come to the end of your days, like my friend did yesterday, you're not going to be grasping to stay here. You're going to say, open the door and let me in. Go in God's peace. Amen.